Hello everyone, welcome back to the first game review of the season with the Strong Opinion Hibs podcast. I'm Charlie and I'm hosting today, joined as always by firstly Calvin. Calvin, how are you doing, mate?
I'm doing fine, thanks, mate.
Good, and Jack's here as well. Jack, how are you?
I'm good. It wasn't a good day football-wise yesterday, but the Hibs won, so that's what it's all about.
Good, aye. We would be joined by new member of the podcast, Aidan, but unfortunately his work permit's not came through yet, so he is not with us today, but should be here soon. So, aye, we're just going to review the St Johnstone game and then preview, obviously, the game against the scum from the other half of the city on Sunday. So, Calvin, I'll come to you first, mate. Around about 2 o'clock on Saturday afternoon, the team news comes out. Pretty strong team, I thought. What was your initial thoughts on the team when you seen it?
I'm with you, mate. I thought it was a really strong team. I thought that it's probably one of the strongest teams we could have put out. And I think that it wasn't much different from what I thought. I thought Cadden maybe had a knock beforehand, so I never put him down as being on my team. I think Lewis Miller starting over him at right back. Other than that, mate, I think I was pretty much spot on with certain of my predictions. But nah, it seems like the team that I think we'll probably see for the next couple games. It's a strong team. I think there's got quite a lot of strengths throughout the team. Like centre backs are pretty strong. That midfield three, I quite like the look of it, Joel Newell, Henderson, and Kenny as well. I kind of like how it's a midfield three, but I feel like Henderson's actually allowed to play a little bit and allowed to attack. Whereas the other two seem to be sort of that more sort of, you know, defensive sort of midfield type. But Joe Neal can still pick out a pass in that. Melkerson out on the right, I like that. I think through the middle last year, he didn't really get as involved as he maybe would have liked to have. But I think having him, because he can play, remember, when we first signed him, one of the big points was that he can play anywhere across the front three, so left, right, or through the middle. So I think, obviously, I would probably have him down as a left-hand-sided, being his favoured side. But him playing on the right, I thought, happy with that. I like to see him on the team sheet. Jimmy Boko's laddie. I was excited to see him start as well. I think obviously if we're going to be bringing someone like that in, it would be good to see them on the team sheet. And then Yuan, I thought it was nice to see him start. He's just had his work permit and that through, and I think it was a good game. Just get him in the mix. Do you know what I mean? Like no point trying to bleed him in that. Just get him out there and get him stuck in. Looks like a big strong laddie. So. I was really positive with that, mate. And obviously, Marshall and goals and kind of get much better than that.
Aye, true. Jack, were you be surprised to see Cabraja and Yuan playing get a start after the work minutes just came through, or were you sort of expecting them to start?
I was expecting it. I think Cabraja, especially, I think I was expecting Yuan as well. But Cabraja, especially, obviously, he's a player that I've been talking up recently because I'm a big football hipster. So I know about the Eastern European leagues where he's been playing. And he's a player that I was always excited to see. And of course, he went through that Hearts so-and-so McGowan in the game. But if you look at his stats in the game, Cabraja, I mean, he had some good stats in the game. I mean, it doesn't lie. I think he's hit the ground running, and I expected that. When I seen him start, I thought he's going to have a good game. You know, he's a big, mean Croatian, and these are the sorts of games that will suit him. So, yeah, I wasn't too surprised at all, though, mate. I think, you know, it's a good game, as Calvin said about you, and to put them in. You know, St Johnstone are, to put it politely, a typical lower half of the table Scottish team. They're mean, they're nasty. They're going to play most of the team behind the ball. So I think it was always good to sort of get the lads in there. And I think St Johnstone's a very good team to play them against to get them used to Scottish football. So not surprising the slightest, to be honest.
Mm. Jack, right. You look a bit like Cabraja, by the way, sitting there. I see if you had a wee bit of facial hair, mate. You look like Cabraja.
I said I shaved this morning. I would have, if I'd be a bit stubble, would they look like I'm a wee bit. both handsome boys, eh? But,
what did you make of the first half then, Jack? I thought Hibs came out the traps pretty well. Thought we started really well. Dominant team first half. What was sort of your takes on it? Any points that you want to bring up from the first half?
Well, first I've got to say is I watched on highlights because Viva La Plastics, but the Livy Centre HSC. But I think to be honest, yeah, I've got to agree with what you said there, Charlie. We came out the traps really well, playing with sort of. I mean, I'd say the first 10 minutes of the first half were better than anything we had under Maloney. To be honest, you know, I think we're moving the ball about well. We looked aggressive. We were creating. Maybe just need to have. I think, and there's something a lot of people picked up on is maybe just need to have that little bit more. Of an edge that sort of final third. But, you know, that's something that we've had a problem with for a long, long time now, and it'll come. I think, you know, we've got the players, and if we're creating chances and we're looking aggressive going forward, then to me, you know, I'm not overly concerned. So, yeah, I think the first half, like it's just like you said, and I've got to agree with that, we just looked really good coming out the traps from what I've seen in the highlights. And the main thing for me is the sort of intent we were sort of possessing when we were going forward. We just looked really good. And I think to make a difference with Hibs, we were a joy to watch, to be honest, from what I've seen, you know, really good sort of free-flowing, fast attacking football, which is what you want to see. And I think it's good to see, because I think in the past, obviously, used to come up to McDermott Park and struggle quite a bit, because St Johnstone are a team that like to just dig in and to make it difficult for you. And I think that didn't really faze us, to be honest. I think we were just looking good and we were playing our game, which I think something that I've been crying out for at Hibs for a long time is, instead of worrying about what the other team are doing, which I think we tend to do, you've seen it under Jack Ross and Sean Maloney, we were too worried about, oh, they're defensive and everything like that. I think we just came there and played our game, and that's what's good to see. So the first half for me, I'd say, yeah, we needed maybe that wee bit more killer instinct, but we were looking good going forward, and we were moving the ball about well, like I was saying. So, yeah, I was really happy with that.
Aye, and Calvin, obviously the big main talking point in the first half in a Hibs jersey was probably the amount of chances we created, and obviously Gier put one over the bar and a few other chances missed. How good was that to see that we weren't afraid to shoot like we were for majority of last season?
No, I think it was good to see that we shot. And I think is it Kenny had one that he just blared over the bar that Joel Newell sort of missed out on. And you know what? Like, they'll be a bit rusty and they'll be still trying to get back into the flow of things and that. And I think, like I said, I mean, I think probably more than anyone on any Hibs podcast are probably crying out for us just to have a shot on goal. If you don't buy a ticket, you ain't going to win the lottery. Do you know what I mean? So it's good to see that. But I also feel like, just like Jack says, we need to be more clinical. And the main reason for that being, I mean, 14 shots and one on target, and thankfully that one did go in. So it does still seem to be an issue for us. Obviously, we kept a clean sheet, which was very positive as well. But, you know, we were kind of okay at keeping it out our own net last year. We just weren't very good at going forward and scoring goals. So I think we're maybe still a bit weak. Our weakest area is probably still that attacking, the attack. And that's why I wasn't crying out for an old head like Stephen Fletcher or something like that to come in. Someone who knows where the back of the net is, has been there, done it at different levels and different clubs and different leagues. I think Johan, obviously it was a big game to throw him. Wasn't a big game to throw him into, but I mean, he's just got his work permit. He's just moved here. And if you heard Lee Johnson saying, you know, some of the guys in this team, they don't even have bank accounts for that set up yet. Do you know what I mean? Or like, still getting their accommodation and things of that sort. So their lives will be all up in the air in that at the moment. You know, a lot of aspects of it. And they were saying, like, have to borrow money for clubs and that, if the club that's not getting enough of a bank account. So for him to do that and then sort of show up to play in the first game, their first game of the season, he's still obviously got a lot of adjusting to, not just in terms of like the team, but life in Scotland as well. So I think in a couple of weeks' time, we will see him probably become more of a focal point, especially playing right through the middle. Like I say, Luke's a big, strong laddie. And I think one of the things with this team as well that doesn't seem to worry me is we maybe don't have an out-and-out scorer that we can see immediately, but I think there's goals from around the team. And I think that, so you can see that, I think Melkerson will score a few this year. I think Henderson will pop up with a couple. You know, I think there'll be plenty of folk chipping in. But no, like you say, it's good to see us, from what I've seen, absolutely dominate St Johnstone in terms of like possession. Was it 70% possession? 14 shots on goal compared to their four. You know, we had double the amount of passes they had as well, 444 passes, you know what I mean? So, lots of positives so far from what I've seen there, mate. Lots of positives. And I'm actually feeling a lot better about the season, I'll be honest with you. I wasn't really looking forward to it, but I'm actually looking forward to it after this opening game.
Aye. I think first half was, for me, I think we should have scored a couple of chances that we, like Gier's one, I think if we'd put it across the box, mm-hmm. I think that's 1-0, and obviously Kenna's one, like you said, and Henderson missed one as well, but I thought we looked good, and you know, Gier down the left-hand side looks a threat. I've seen people claim on Twitter that he's the worst Hibs player they've ever seen, but that's an absolutely ludicrous shout, because he's nowhere near it, in my opinion, anyway. But you know what it's like. You know what it's like. People write players off after.
Give Boko's laddie a chance.
So obviously there wasn't really much to say about the second half, except there was one red card, one potential red card, and a last minute winner. So we'll dive into them. So we'll talk first one. Jack, we'll come to you on this one. Murray Davidson, 57 minutes into the game, about decapitates Portis's leg. So I've seen Callum Davidson say it's not a red card. So have you got anything to say to the St Johnstone manager about that one?
Well, when you're doing the dole office after getting the sack, you can tell them on the line. No, I think it was a red. I mean, that it's a shocking challenge to be making. And to be fair, if the boot had been another foot and Portis had done that damage, oh, he's a criminal, he's a thug, he shouldn't be playing in the game, it's disgraceful. The mass horde of Rangers keyboard warriors would be going mental. You know, the keyboard bears would be going mental about it. But I think, yeah, so it's a red card. And I'll say that it is. I mean, in the letter of the law, that's a red card. In the spirit of the law, it's a red card. Because like I said, the boot's on the other foot and Portis goes through Davidson like that, then they'd be going mental. So I think, yeah, and obviously managers are going to be like that. Like, I mean, he's going to come out and say, "Oh, it's not a red card." Every manager does that. You know, I think we've got to accept, no matter what level in the game it is, managers will say that. But I just think there's times where Callum, unfortunately, he just talks out his backside, and I think it's deflecting. A lot of St Johnstone fans say that he deflects when they lose, and he does it big time. And I think for me, that was part of it. Is he's trying to blame the red card for the fact that they lost. I think that was, you could tell a lot of that for his post-match. So I think a lot of St Johnstone fans are just getting fed up of him. So I would say that for a St Johnstone point of view. But yeah, for me, mate, it was a red every day. And it's a shocking one to be making. And just sort of sums up St Johnstone, as I think you see it, is when they get frustrated, well, I don't know what their game plan is, let's park the bus. But you know what I mean? I think when they get frustrated out of what they want to do, they start getting aggressive like that. I mean, you've seen it at Easter Road in the last game of the season when we were 3-0 up on them. They started crunching into some horrible challenges, and I think that's what St Johnstone are as a team. And they lack it without the likes of Kerr. They lack any sort of class for me. I think it was players like Kerr that made it for them when they won the double. So yeah, I think for me it just sums up St Johnstone as a team, and it was every day I read. It was disgusting. It was disgusting, to be honest. And I've got to say that. And obviously we'll come on to talking about Cabraja's one later. But I think for me you can't be doing that and be expecting to win a game. You know, okay, you might want to make a few last ditch tackles here and there and pick up a yellow, take one for the team. But there was no need to do what he did. There was no need for Murray Davidson to do what he did. It was a silly challenge to make, and he deserved to be getting sent into the dressing room early for that. An early shower was very much deserved. And yeah, it's just typical St Johnstone, an utter gang at times, to be honest.
For sure. Calvin, what was your thoughts on it, mate? Did you agree with Callum Davidson, or was that a deserved red card?
I don't know. It's a very strong challenge, and I don't think it was. I think the challenge was, it wasn't really necessary. I mean, he could have. It comes from a bad first touch from him when he's obviously trying to clear the ball on the edge of his own box. He takes a touch and it sort of bobbles away from him, and you can see Porteous, who almost anticipates a challenge coming from him, just take that extra touch and push it away. But he could have just stayed on his feet. Like, it was avoidable. He could have stayed on his feet and jockeyed him, because Portis has taken a heavy touch, by the looks of things, gone down the out towards the byline. And there's another St Johnstone player there as well. So it wasn't like they were in, like, Ken, a last-ditch tackle, where they were like he didn't need to make a last-ditch tackle. They didn't really seem like they were under any pressure at that point. Like, I can't understand why he's dived in like that. But I will say, it's interesting because I'll probably contradict myself here. Look, I like seeing good challenges in the game. I mean, it gets people up out their seat and it gets them engaged. At the same time, I think you need to nip stuff like that in the bud very early on, because last year against Celtic, Carter Vickers, or was it Carter Vickers or who was it? Starfield had his hands all over Nisbet all game. We nudges in the back, we knees in the back of the leg. Before you know it, Ken, he's out for the best part of a year. Nisbet. And things like that. I mean, if that challenge, if he did injure Portis, Ken, where do we go from there? Do you know what I mean? Like, you can't really be making challenges like that. And I think it was red. I think it was definitely reckless, and it probably was a red. But then again, Cabraja's, I'm obviously got to be delighted with that just because who it was on. Mm-hmm. But again, I don't know. What was he trying to do? Was he trying to win over the fans and let them ken that the rest of the league that he'd arrived or something like that, or what? Like, I don't know. But I just think the positioning of Murray Davidson's tackle and the time in terms of, like, it was still 0-0 at that point. Like, why has he done that? I don't understand it. Stupid tackle, and he's given the referee a decision to make. And if Joe Newell got sent off against Santa Coloma for his tackle, then aye, that's a red card.
Aye, you're not wrong. And Calvin, I'll stay with you for Cabraja's one. Personally, I think it was a booking. I don't think it's a red card. So I think the difference between the two is that Cabraja gets the ball, Davidson gets purchases his thigh. So what was sort of your thought on that one? Obviously, you just said that he didn't really see the point of him making the tackle, but do you think that's sort of what we've maybe been lacking in tackles recently? Like someone that's going to not fly into it like a Ryan Borges style, but crunch the ball and win it?
I definitely think that in the past, Hibs have probably been a bit powder puff all over the park. And we certainly do tend to get, you know, bullied by teams. I would say so anyway. And I think having someone that's, you know, especially in a derby or against Rangers or something like that, you know, like a big game, just to go stick at 6-2-3s, because I can't really say you got to protect the player like how Nisbet, and that was obviously, I thought that should have been nipped in the bud much quicker. But other folk around the league do it. It's quite nice to see that somebody's got a wee bit, the guy's obviously got something about him, do you know what I mean? And for him to leave one on McGowan was good. And I think it was good in a way, because obviously it was against McGowan and we were all like, "Wait, get up, be a jumbo." But at the same time, just going off last year, I think our discipline was absolutely shocking last year. Our disciplinary record was absolutely shocking. I think we might have had the most red cards in the league, or the second most. I can't mind off the top of my head, but we were certainly up there. And I just feel like, do you know what? Yeah, it's good to have that somebody's got a bit of venom in them. But at the same time, we need to keep 11 players in the park at all times this season, because we let ourselves down with that last season, just the lack of professionalism. Like two people getting sent off Jack Ross's last game, Livingston away, Porteous getting sent off. Again, it wasn't a red card, I mean, Rangers and things like that. But we need to be smart. We need to be smart this year, and I just don't think we can afford to really be lunging into tackles like Cabraja done, because if he'd done that and he's out for the derby, then he's out for the Rangers game, Kim, that could potentially be us 3 games in with 3 points. You know what I mean? Like, how that was going, Kim, we could have been sitting with, you know, 1 point or something like that, with a draw away to St Johnstone. If we were doing it to 10 men, Kim, would we won that match? I'm not sure. So I think it's good that we can stand up for ourselves and we can compete physically. But I don't think we need to make rash tackles at all. I think we just need to try and keep as many folk as we can in the park, because the best of times we can't win when there's 11 folk on it. So how the hell we got to deal with 10, I think we'll be struggling.
Aye, switching gears, Jack, before we come to the goal, and I never touched on this before, Cabraja's tackle, but what did you, obviously there was 4 substitutes in the game, but obviously 3 of them came before Cabraja's booking. So what did you think of seeing first Dimitri Mitchell back on the park for Hibs?
I think obviously it's good to have Demi back, because I think he's a player that does offer a lot. I think we didn't see enough of him last season because he got injured pretty quickly. But I liked him when he did play. Obviously, he got that goal against was it Livingston that he scored against?
And Arbroath.
So, you know, I think he's got a goal in him. Unfortunately, the one against Livingston ended up no counting for much, but the one against Arbroath did. And of course, that was very difficult conditions that day as well. So, fair play to him. I think he looks good, Demi Mitchell. So, it's good to have him back. It's an extra feather in our cap, if you like, Demi Mitchell. And hopefully, he's good that if he comes on in the derby to, you know, really stick it to them. But I think, to be honest, he's a player that I like, and hopefully we're going to maybe get a lot more out of him this season now that he's fit and he's got a full season to sort of work on his game. And I don't think he's a starter, obviously, with the players we've brought in, but I think he'll do a job for us off the bench. It was good to see him coming back on, because it's always good to see players recovering from an injury and everything like that.
Aye, definitely. I think Lee Johnson made musings of that in his interview midweek there, that he's going to be in and around the squad. And I think if it is a utility man off the bench, then I'm okay with that, because he's a good player. And really took the game to St Johnstone when he came on. Calvin, I'll come to you for this one. Doidge came on to replace Melkerson. Were you surprised that he brought Doidge on instead of Bojang, or did you think Doidge sort of offers us a wee bit more in a game like that?
I think Doidge's hold-up play is really good, and I think maybe he was just trying to get Doidge on to sort of stick the ball up there and keep the ball up and then around the penalty area. And obviously, you could see when Doidge scored his hat-trick against, it was Clyde, right?
Aye.
He sometimes can get in the right place at the right time and get on the end of things, and he's big and lanky as well, and it might have just been sort of the front three that we had were quite small, and putting Doidge in there in terms of being tall and physical might have just gave St Johnstone another dimension to think of, to think about, and maybe it would have been a wee bit unfair on Bojan sort of chucking him in with what how many ever minutes were to go, and maybe expecting him to turn the game around, where Doidge has been in that situation before where he has went on as a sub and been able to have an impact. So I think maybe just relying on Doidge's sort of experience and things like that maybe is the reason that he chucked him on instead. But no, as I say, I like big Doidge. I think he's good. I think he's all right, like, especially when he's fully fit. I still think he's not 100%, unfortunately. But no, I'm fairly happy with Doidge being in and around the team.
I think he definitely offered something off the bench. I don't think he'll play much this season, but if he's in and around the team, then until Nisbet comes back at least, then it's not really a bad thing to have that physical presence up front, because we didn't really have that, do we, with the three, except maybe McGeady, but obviously he's out for 12 weeks now, so
aye,
we'll have that. Jack, coming on to the next sub, Josh Campbell replaced Chris Cadden. Josh Campbell seems to be moving back into his natural defensive role, which is what Aidan was speaking about last time when he was on the podcast and it was Sonny sent him to us. So what did you think of that? Do you think it's a good move bringing Campbell on in his more natural position? Because he seemed to be a bit lost in midfield last season. So are you happy that he's been played back in his natural position?
Yep, I think definitely for me. And I know Aidan spoke about it as well. And I think it's something that I was musing about a few times that, yeah, I mean, Josh Campbell's more naturally a defender at every club he'd been at on loan and everything like that as well. When he's at FC Edinburgh, when he was at Airdrie, he was always played in defence. When he was at our academy, he was always played in defence. So I think it's good to see him getting pushed back there, because I think Sean Maloney and Jack Ross didn't use him correctly. And I think now that Lee Johnson's pushing him back into his more sort of natural realm, he's looked good. And obviously, he got his reward, which we'll obviously move on to. But I think, yeah, I've got to admit, in the words of Bob Servant, yeah, it was a bit of a boo boy for Josh Campbell. But I think, you know, the lad, he's a young lad. And now that he's in a position that he's more suited to, he has looked a better player. I mean, every game I've seen him play back in defence so far this season, he's looked good. So, yeah, I think when he came on, I wasn't surprised. I thought that's what Lee Johnson's been doing with the substitutes. He's been bringing Campbell on to play sort of back in defence. So, yeah, I saw it and thought, you know what, that's a good move. Cadden's probably, you know, just sort of ran his race, and bring Campbell on and see what he can do, because I think Campbell is good in these games against physical sides. And it's, like I said, it turned out to be a bit of a super sub in the end, didn't it? So, yeah, I was happy to see Campbell coming on. And I hope Josh really comes on to a good one this season, because he looks like he's already improving, which is good to see.
I think I was surprised that Campbell got the nod over Miller, but obviously we're coming on to the goal now. So, you know, it was obviously good to see that he did get the goal. And right before the corner came on, Jake Doyle-Hayes came on as well. So it's good to see boys like Doyle-Hayes, Mitchell, that have been a wee bit plagued by injury, are back fit. So hopefully that obviously adds numbers to the squad, and the bench looked a wee bit stronger on Saturday as well, which is always good to see. So, Calvin, obviously we get the goal. I thought it was never coming in that stand. And the celebrations that me and my wee brother and my dad done when the goal went in were nothing short of a sigh of relief, I think. What did you make of the goal? Obviously, big claims on St Johnstone's Twitter that Rocky Hand bought it, but I don't know if they need their eyes tested because it comes off McPherson's chest. But your thoughts on the goal, mate?
I think it was, I think over the whole course, I think it was deserved, and I think it was something that, you know, we probably didn't really get enough of last year in terms of like rub of the green or a bit of luck. And I think a bit of luck goes a long way, and I think obviously it was quite a lucky goal. but I've seen different angles of it. I've seen the angle where it looks like it comes off Rocky's hand, and I've also seen that angle where it comes off off the chest, and I think you can play, you can look at it either way and make a case for either way. But I tell you what, I hope he punched into the net, and especially with that name Rocky, big right hand in the net, and hopefully he does it again against the Hearts. But nah, that's it, just pile pressure on for Hibs to score for a corner is, I mean, I've not even got to crack that joke because I'll rattle so many folk if I see if Hibs ever scored for a corner.
I mean, but to be fair, it was his wee brother that put the corner in as well, so. Henderson delivered
absolutely, and I think the way the players celebrated in that, I think that's what sort of, I think the way they celebrated together, and you could see like the passion on their faces. I think that's something that really grasped me, because as of late, I'll be honest with you, I've been feeling really like disconnected for the club and a wee bit out of touch, just because it's like you say, you promised the world and you delivered nothing 9 times out of 10 with Hibs, and I feel like, I just feel like that with Hibs, and I feel like, when I seen them all buzzing and like how much it actually meant to them, I thought, oh, wow, like, seems like this group of players actually really get it. And they're absolutely buzzing, like, you know, they're not just here for a wage, like, they're absolutely buzzing that they've won. And I really, really like that. And that's, like I said, that sort of grabbed my attention. And I thought, oh, Christ, like, Kim, I was delighted for them.
I definitely. And Jack, I'll come sort of looking at it from a different angle for the goal. What was it like? Obviously, none of you could make the game. I was there, so I was in and about the celebrations. But what does it mean to you seeing 3,000 Hibs fans celebrate a last minute winner at Perth? It must be a good thing that we took that many fans to a game.
I mean, I was watching it, wishing I'd actually went now, but obviously, like with work and everything like that, you know, it's a bit difficult for me to be going to all these away games because I've got on early shifts, and before Hibs Twitter starts calling me a plastic. No, I'm kidding. But I think it's just great to see. I think, you know, the way last season went, it's just great to finally see like that connection. I think obviously at the end of last season, myself and you went to Livy away, and it was like a completely different vibe for that. You know, the away games last season, you could see fans were getting agitated, fans were getting upset, the players didn't really want to interact with fans, and it's completely different to see that basically, because let's be honest, like St John's had basically sold half the ground to us. It was like a mini Easter Road, you know, with that many Hibs fans were in it. That you know, to see that many Hibs fans just celebrating and the passion on the players' faces, it's amazing. And I think it's usual, I think our fan base gets a lot of stick sometimes, you know, we get called idiots, we get called whatever. And I do apologise for CCTV tapes. I think the thing is, you know, we are a very passionate fan base, and to see those fans celebrate and to see the players going right over, you know, to see the passion on the players' faces, that's what Hibernian Football Club's all about at the end of the day. You know, I think through good times and through bad times, the fans are there, and the players, this group, like Calvin said, they know what it means. I think, you know, it's not that they're picking up a wage. They're playing for this, and that's what it's all about at the end of the day. You know, it's all about the club, it's all about the badge. And I think as someone who's given a lot of time to the club, as I have, you know, volunteering at the stadium and selling the magazines and going and watching the women's team and everything like that, I think it's great to see it at all levels of the club. So yeah, I mean, I had a wee tear in my eye watching the highlights, to be honest, seeing that. And overall, I was just really, really happy, over the moon for Josh as well. I think, you know, he deserved that. Rocky was fantastic in the game, so it's good to see two lads that got a lot of stick last season coming good. So yeah, all in all, it was a very, very great scene to see. And like I said, that's Hibernian Football Club. We can get the piss ripped out of us, we can get ridiculed all we want, but at the end of the day, we're a club that are very passionate, and we'll give our fans that. I think I've been on the wrong end of Hibs Twitter a few times, but it was just great to see everybody having a good time and celebrating together, because that's what football's all about. It's all about playing with friends. So yeah, I was really, really happy.
Definitely. And Callum, I want to touch on Rocky for a couple of minutes before we move on to the Hearts game. So obviously, Rocky, as throw Josh Campbell in the mix as well. Both were sort of the scapegoats towards the end of last season. We had Dre Wright, we had James Scott earlier in the season, but towards the end, it was Campbell and Rocky. So what does it mean or what do you think about Josh Campbell and Rocky both being instrumental in that goal? And you can see in the picture that me and Jack have got that look how passionate Rocky is. Do you think Rocky's starting to win the fans over, and maybe Josh Campbell with his performance on Saturday as well off the bench?
For me, I think I've always been one of the fans that I think has supported Rocky. If you listen back over the podcast, I don't think he's as bad as people make him out to be. And I was quite surprised. The first game I think I seen him play that I was really impressed with was the Edinburgh Derby, Easter Road, the 0-0. And I thought it was a rock that night. I really did. I thought it was an absolute brick wall. And a lot of my Hearts mates were saying, are you being serious, man? What game were you watching? He's absolutely hopeless. And I was like, I didn't see it, eh? And then as time went on, a lot of folks sort of turned on him that, eh? And I thought, Chris, maybe I'm missing something here. But one thing I have noticed is that, and I mentioned it last week, so I didn't want to repeat myself, but last couple of games, like obviously Ken, the one when he booted the last year when he booted the ball at the pitch, like at the stadium. Who was that against again?
Arbroath.
Arbroath. That's because Porteous is at the side of him, shouting at him, trying to walk him through the game and talk him through the game. Porteous doesn't ken the game inside out. Porteous is good, but he's got a lot to learn as well. Do you know what I mean? I think Rocky just needs to play his own game, get the ball on the ground and pick out the pass that he thinks is the right pass. Because if you watch him, Porteous is trying to talk him through the game all the time and shouting at him all the time. And I think that's only going to put stress on the laddie. He's still a young guy, so I'm impressed with Rocky. And I think, you know, I think he gets a lot of unwarranted sort of grief sort of put aimed towards him. I think it's a lot of it's unwarranted. And I certainly don't think he's one of the worst defenders in the team, and I don't think he's one of the worst defenders in the league. Yes, he's lackadaisical at time, and he made a mistake when he should have been out quicker at Tynecastle to close the boy doing in the wing. But at the same time, Ken, there's Hanlon in the middle of the box who ends up on his arse as well. So they were all to blame last season. They were all hopeless at the back. So I think it was quite unfair, and I've said this numerous times in the end of season review, and that I think it was quite unfair just to solely pick him out. So I'm impressed with Rocky. I think he'll grow in it again. But for me, Josh Campbell, it'll take more than a substitution performance to sort of turn my head in terms of how I feel about him. I don't think I'm still not convinced by him. Obviously, I know he's went back to maybe his more natural position, but I just feel like still at this moment, my mind hasn't changed. I still feel like we could do with maybe a better player in and around that position personally. But it's just my personal. I hope to be proved wrong.
I definitely will. To sum up, brilliant performance on Saturday, I felt. Deserved the win, and hopefully we can do it on Sunday against the Hibs. So obviously, big game on Sunday, boys. We've got a second game of the season, first game at home. It's not really a big opponent, though, is it? It's only Hearts. So, Calvin, how are you feeling coming into the game, mate? Are you confident, or are you shitting it, or usual derby feeling?
No, I wouldn't say I'm shitting it. No, I'm actually feeling all right, to be honest with you. I like the look of this team. I was really sceptical beforehand. I didn't want to get too heavily too excited now, like obviously because I'll probably be brought back down to reality come Sunday. But no, I'm feeling all right. I think the team looks good. I think I'm excited to see the new signings, and I'm excited to see sort of how this thing how Lee Johnstone brings it all together. I wouldn't say I'm feeling nervous or that. I think if we could be a bit more clinical and a bit more physical, I think we'll be fine. But I don't think Hearts are as strong as they were last year. And I think a couple more points I'll make throughout the rest of the podcast and then when we come to talk about it. But no, I think we've certainly strengthened in a few areas that will be really important for this game.
Hi, Jack, how are you feeling?
I'm never confident before a derby. It's just one of those ones that I think I'm superstitious where I don't really like to say in either way because that's just the way it is. I think I'm old-fashioned like that. But, you know, I always love the Edinburgh Derby for the atmosphere and the fixture. What happens on the pitch, maybe not so much, but I definitely think, for me coming into this one, is it's a big one for Lee Johnson. It's our first game at home. It's his first league fixture at Easter Road as manager. So I think, to be honest, you know, there's a lot riding on it, and I'm looking forward to it from that perspective. And I think, you know what, it's a big occasion, and hopefully the lads are up for it. Like Calvin said, I think I feel a lot better about the team now after getting the St Johnstone game out of the way. I'm feeling a lot more confident. So we'll just see how it goes. And, you know, I think, like Calvin said again, I think Hearts have need to me, they didn't look all that great against Ross County. I think they were okay. They won, they got the 3 points, but I've seen a lot of my Hearts mates saying, you know, it was a bit of a laboured performance. So mm-hmm. I think they've got that. I think they're not going to be anywhere near that as good as they were last season. I think they'll probably have one eye on Europe as well. You know, might be a bit distracted by that. So I think for me, it's going to be the typical derby type game, but I'm sort of a bit more confident than I'd normally be. Like I said, it's a derby, so I'm always backing it.
All right, Callum, do you think we'll play the same team as we did on Saturday, or do you think there'll be any movement there in the squad, where maybe Campbell coming back in, or what do you think?
No, I think he'll stick with the same team. I think he's got to. I think that team done really well. Like I said, in the stats, so we show that we dominated the game against St Johnstone, which isn't really an easy thing to do, to be honest with you, because they are a tricky side to break down, St Johnstone. I think he'll stick with the same team. I really do. And I think, you know, I wouldn't get too overly excited about Josh Campbell and things like that. I think these are still options we can have off the bench. I don't feel it's perhaps necessary right now to be thinking about changing the team already. I mean, it's a winning team. Just leave it as it is. I think the lack of I've been very vocal about that. I think the lack of consistency over the last couple of seasons in terms of team selection, that especially under the Maloney era, is just doesn't work. So no, keep the same team. I don't think anybody's done anything to perhaps suggest they shouldn't be starting this match. So no, got to get the boys. Got to get.
Definitely agree. And Jack, come to you. What do we need to do to beat Hearts? So obviously, scoring more goals than them is the obvious answer. But what, obviously they're a physical team that like to pump the ball aimlessly from their centre backs to their forwards. That's their usual game plan, is just to hoof the ball. So is it the type of game that we just need to get the ball down and pass it, or do we need to run at them, or what do you think? If you were Lee Johnson setting the team up, how would you go about it?
Break some ankle. No, I'm kidding. I think the thing is to be honest, you need to find a happy balance between both. I think Hearts are a team that like to, you know, sort of put the ball over the top. They like to hoof it up to the strikers, and it worked at Tynecastle. You know, as soon as we went 1-0 up, we stopped playing, and then look at what happened. And you look at the balls we're putting over the top to Sims in that, in the Scottish Cup semi-final as well. And I think that's a threat we're going to need. We need to be tight, and I mean super tight at the back. We cannot afford to make even the slightest mistake, because you've seen it last season. If Hearts smell blood, they go for it. And I think that's the problem. We need to be tight at the back, and don't be afraid to send boys into the stand. That's what I'm saying. We've got boys like Rocky, Cabraja, that aren't afraid to get stuck in there. And if it means picking up a yellow card, it means picking up a yellow card. I want to see my defenders getting, you know, nasty and putting their bodies on the line in a derby, because that's what a derby's all about. You know, I think to use a sort of analogy from yesterday's England and Germany players in the Women's Euro final, England and Germany's a big rivalry. They weren't afraid to get stuck in. Neither side were afraid to get stuck in and pick up a few yellow cards here and there. And I think that's what we need to be seeing. We just need to get stuck into them and be physical. Hearts are going to be mean. They're going to get in our faces, so we need to give them the same. I think in terms of being at the back, we need to be tight. That's the main thing for me. Like I said, you just need to be competent in defence. No silly mistakes. Don't be afraid to get stuck into guys. Don't be afraid to see a guy like Forrest or Shankland. Just don't be afraid to send them into the stand. Get stuck in there, because if you do not take a guy like Shankland out, if you like. Obviously, within the laws of the game, I'm not condoning injuring anybody before people get upset. But I think, you know, you need to just clear them out, because if you give a guy like Shankland a Forest, the operating room, they're going to cause problems. And I think in terms of going forward, yeah, don't try and hoof it up. Just play nice one-touch football, nice passes. Get it out wide. I think getting it out wide is going to be the big thing. You'll get to Jair or another wide players, or try and get through the middle to the likes of Ewan and start trying to run through them. I think that's the big thing we could do to Hearts. I think we're going to hurt Hearts for pace. And I think trying to run through them is the right idea. If you catch them off guard, I think the counter-attack could work quite well for us in the derby, to be honest. If you catch Hearts off guard, get it to Ewan. And, you know, I've seen it. I mean, he's like, zoom, you know, get him right through. And that's going to start causing them problems right there as well. So I think for me, the two main things are competency in defence and get out to our sort of tricky, fast players, because that's what's going to cause them problems. I want to try and keep the ball away from midfield as much as possible. I think midfield are going to get bogged down. Then again, we do have Kenneth, so he looks like he's not afraid to get stuck in there as well. But I think I'd try and keep the ball away from midfield as much as possible, because Hearts are, suppose it's an area that they always sort of tend to outdo us in, apart from when we had the good midfield like McGinn and everything like that. So I think we've got to watch out for that. But yeah, I think for me, it's all about, like you said, Charlie, keeping the ball on the deck, because they're just going to try and get over the top. And we don't need to play that game, to be honest. I think we are better than that. I think we should just try and play the sort of fast flowing stuff that we're playing against St Johnstone.
Yeah, definitely. And Calvin, obviously, Hearts last season, Craig Gordon won them a lot of points. And obviously, we've now got David Marshall. So are you expecting the both keepers to be, obviously they're both cracking keepers, are you expecting both of them to be busy this Sunday?
I'm expecting them both to play an important role in sort of the outcome of the obviously the outcome of the game. But no, I think for us, like I said, I think one of the areas we've really strengthened is David Marshall, and I think that takes a lot of pressure off the back four. I think it takes a lot of pressure off the back four knowing that they've got someone of his quality behind them. And one thing was that also Aidan picked up on the weekend, there was how vocal Marshall is. And you've seen him as well. Like he's no here just to sort of take it for a retirement. He's here, he still enjoys football. And there was one shot that St Johnstone got away, which didn't need to happen, because there was two or three defenders that could have been out and closed the ball down. And the boy pinged it, and Marshall was straight off his line, shouting at his defence and organising his defence. And we need someone like that who can put Porteous and that in their place, and, you know, Teo Rocky and that, and even the midfielders and that, Kim. Can't let that happen, because we can't afford to let that happen against Hearts either. So I feel like he's very strong, coming for corners and things like that, close range shots. I feel much more, probably the most confident I've ever felt in terms of having an actual solid goalkeeper. And I think that goes a long way. But Gordon's obviously very good as well, but he's made a few mistakes towards the end of last season and things like that, and he's always good, isn't he?
So unfortunately, yeah. Gordon is a very, very good keeper. So, Calvin, I'll start with you here, mate. What's your score prediction for this for Sunday?
I think it'll be. It's really hard to predict, because the obvious one is 0-0. That's probably the most obvious scoreline to go for, because I want to say, I've got a feeling it could be 3-0 Hibs. I feel like we might just come out and surprise them, and there'll be a lot of folk, this will be, you know, click, this will get clipped and punted around once we get beat. But no, I just think that if Hibs can come out, and Lee Johnson would have had this game on his calendar, do you know what I mean, marked, and they were looking forward to this, and I'm sure he'll be getting the boys up for it, because a lot of these boys as well, they're all keen now. Hopefully they'll be able to get one back over that lot. Do you know what I mean? Because we've had a lot of defeats off them, obviously, last season and things like that. So I just feel like I feel it can go one of two ways. We don't score a lot of goals, so to say it's got to be 3-0 is quite stupid, to be honest with you. But I feel like if we score one, Hearts might not know what's happened, and we could possibly get a second just with that wee lift we get. So I'll put my neck on the line and I'll say 2-0 Hibs.
2-0. Jack, what's yours, mate?
I'm going to say 1-1. I think it's going to be a draw. I think any Edinburgh Derby in my time that's been sort of really hyped up ends up being a draw or a Hearts win, but I never predict them to win anything. So I'm going to say 1-1. I think they'll go 1-0 up. I have a feeling they'll go 1-0 up, but we'll get back to 1-1 and then the game will just sort of peter out for there. And I'm going to say it'll be Yuan to get our goal.
I'm going to say it's going to be 1-0 Hibs, and I think we'll score early on, and I think we'll hold on for dear life, put F11 behind the ball and have a famous victory at Easter Road. And I think...
Finally.
I'm trying to think who'll score. Who would I love to see score the goal? Rocky. I'd like to see Rocky get the winner. That would be class to see him finally get a goal, because he deserves it. So, obviously, Hibs women have been in action towards the end of their pre-season fixtures. So, Jack, we were away down to Sunderland yesterday. Unfortunately, a disappointing result. So, what did you think of the result? Because obviously there wasn't many updates. We got a half-time and a full-time update, but what did you think of losing 3-1 to Sunderland?
I don't think there's much shame in it at all. I think, you know, Sunderland are a very... I've seen this in the... Obviously, we have a WhatsApp, and I've seen this in... Sunderland are a very well-established side in England. And obviously, England have just won the Euros. I think you can see how much the women's game's growing there. And Sunderland are a very, very good team. You know, they were established in English football very early on. They won the FA Cup. They were in the WSL for a number of years. And then as the women's game became professional in England, they sort of slid down and went into the Championship. But they've always been in and around the top of the Championship, Sunderland. And I think there's no shame in losing to a good team like that at all. I think we played quite well. Your Dean obviously had said the scoreline didn't reflect the game. We played better than 3-1. So I think it's good that we went down there and gave a team like that a good game. And obviously we got a goal, which is good. It was trialist one. It scored the goal. Who that is, we don't know. It'll be interesting to see. Hopefully there's maybe a new face going to be coming in soon.
That was a proud day for trialist mum and trialist dad.
Exactly. But remember, trialist one mum and trialist two didn't even get off the bench, I don't think. So you can't get confused there. But no, I think... I've got a few ideas as to who it might be, but I'll keep my cards close to my chest on that one. But I think it's good to see that we scored against a team like that. And it's good to see that we gave a decently established English side a run for the money. Because I think most Scottish teams outside the Glasgow three, the Championships, where they'd be in England. So I think it's good to see we were sort of giving Sunderland a good run for their money. So yeah, overall, I think it's been a good pre-season. Two confident results against good Scottish sides, and then we don't know what happened in the friendly against Durham because they didn't want the score publicised or anything like that. And obviously we did, from what I can gather, because obviously we didn't get many updates, but then again, that's Sunderland's wishes and we've got to respect that as a visiting team. I think against Sunderland, from what Dean was saying, we did all right. So I think all in all, it's been a good pre-season. Of course, the season starts on Sunday. I think it's a bit silly of the SPFL to have made the opening fixtures the same day as an Edinburgh Derby, but I'm obviously not Neil Doncaster because I'm much more intelligent than the man. But obviously, I think that's a bit silly. But of course, we start off against Celtic. I think, to be honest, you know, it's going to be a tough game. We can't really say otherwise. I don't know what's happening with the Cypriot players yet. Crystal, Liana, Eleni and Christina, I just don't know what's happening there at all. I know that Christina and Eleni are in Scotland because I've seen them at the airport in Cyprus, in Nicosia. So they're obviously flying to Edinburgh. I don't know about Crystal and Liana. So I think we have a bit of a thin squad heading into that game against Celtic. And it's going to be tough. We know how good of a side Celtic are. They did the double last season in the Cups. They'll be wanting to win the league because I think that was one thing, you know, hearing Fran Alonso talk, that was one big thing he was disappointed in last season, is Celtic dropped out the title race pretty early. And he wants them in challenging for that. I think he's got an axe to grind with Rangers. So I think Celtic will be wanting to hit the ground running. And I have a horrible feeling that we might end up being on the wrong end of another sort of heavy scoreline because of that, because Celtic will be wanting to hit the ground running in the league campaign and get it going. And obviously, they've got Amy Gallagher in there, they've really strengthened Celtic. So I think for me, it's going to be a tough one. I think lineup wise, I'd like to see Haaland in goal. I think it would be good to see her in there. Nor Mustafa, I would like to see Nor start. She's looked good from what I've sort of seen and heard from pre-season. And then, of course, we'd like to see Poppy Lawson and Ava in there as well, because I think both of them are good players. I think all the new players that are available to us will start, aside from Ailey Tebbit, who, of course, I think she will be playing back up to Haaland for most of the season. So, yeah, I think that's it lineup-wise. And for a score prediction, I'm going to say, unfortunately, I'm going to say 2-0 Celtic, because I know sort of when we did the... sort of talk about the women's team, I did say we maybe get a draw, but now looking at it and thinking that Celtic will be wanting to go in for the league this season, I think it's going to be 2-0 Celtic, unfortunately. But I think there's no shame in that. After that, the fixtures do get a bit kinder to us. So I think it's a case of maybe just getting the Celtic game out of the way and focusing on it from there. But yeah, I think I'm excited for Hibs women. Obviously, we've made some big changes and we've made some big moves, and we've got some exciting new faces and so on. All excited for the season ahead, and it's good to have the girls back on Sunday as well. Albeit, I think it's a bit stupid in SPFL to make an opening day of the Women's League the same day as such a big fixture as the Men's Edinburgh Derby.
Very true, very true. But unfortunately, that's the way it goes. Calvin, what's your thoughts going on to the game on Sunday, mate? Do you think? Obviously, it's a tough game playing Celtic. They are strengthened really well this summer. Do you think we'll get a good result?
Considering we never beat one of the Glasgow three last year, I feel like it'll be another test, and I feel like this is again. I feel a bit sorry for Dean because it's kind of another rebuild for him in terms of like he's lost quite a lot of players at the end of that season, like Alexa and things like that, and a few others. Obviously, we lost Kavanagh, we lost
Amy
Gallagher, we lost her to Celtic. So I think it's going to be a challenge. I think in pre-season there's been really good signs of what Dean's trying to bring back or what he's trying to create this year. But I think I don't think Celtic are as good as the other two. I think it'll be 1-1.
I think it'll be 1-1 as well, mate. I think we'll get a result.
I think we're all right, aye.
Aye, so that brings us to the end of the podcast this week. We'll be back later in the week with our women's season preview episode. We've got a bumper episode, like what we've done with the men's. We've done it for the women's team as well. And then we'll be back next week to review, hopefully, a derby win at Easter Road and look ahead to the next couple of games. So until next time, come on, Hibs.